This is our Christmas affirmation. Advent hope moves us. Advent love leads us. Advent joy stirs us. Advent peace stills us, that we may affirm our King Jesus. It is time we set flame to this Advent affirmation by lighting the Christ candle. We believe that Jesus is the Son of God. He was born of the Virgin Mary in Bethlehem of Judea. He was a long-awaited Messiah whose coming was prophesied. The same Jesus lives today in our hearts. He deserves our highest loyalty and total commitment. In Christ Jesus, our hope is fulfilled, our love is consummated, our joy is complete, and our peace is sealed. Rejoice, a Savior is born. A Savior is born indeed. Joy to the world.
Child, go between all. Hello, everyone. This is Daniel Simon, the Associate Minister here at Grace. I just have one little thing to say as we get started with the children's program. This is the fruit of several months, several times of getting together. The kids would record little bits here and there. I had this idea floating around in my head. I tried the best to explain it to them, and I think they got excited. They did have done a wonderful job with considering the situation that we find ourselves in. It's an unexpected year. This is an unexpected way to do a Christmas program, but I think that they did some really wonderful thing. I wanted to thank the girls that sang. That is Adeline Kozan, Iris Kozan, Rachel Staley, Harper Rodemeyer, and Ellie Simonton. Thank you, girls, so much for what you've done. I know it wasn't easy, but I appreciate it very much. And all the other kids who were able to do it, I thank you, parents, for making it possible. And I know it was difficult, but hopefully next year we won't have to be worrying about this here. And mainly, I just want to tell you, as I do every Sunday, I hope that you're doing well, and that you would prepare your hearts to receive God's grace.
In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her.
So as our story begins, the fire burns bright, and we meet a teenage girl named Mary. Faithful this girl was, and something was about to happen that would change her life and the world. You see, Mary had a little visit from an angel. Now, an angel visit isn't very common, so needless to say, she was a bit shocked. You see, the angel told Mary she was going to have a baby, and she was a bit confused. She wasn't even married. How could this be? But I've learned that when an angel talks, it's best to stop and listen. The angel had so much to say to Mary, and Mary had to think about these things. The things the angel talked about were new, strange, and scary. Because this angel said that this baby would be God's son. And you know what? Mary trusted God and believed he could do something great and miraculous through her. She believed that through God, all things are possible. And she was left alone that night to worship the God who had sent an angel to her and ponder the things he promised her.
Bethlehem. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to his own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in the manger, because there was no room for them in the inn.
So when Mary was heavily pregnant, it came time that she and Joseph had to leave their town and go up to a city called Bethlehem. You see, a governor had ordered a census or a counting of the people, and well, they had no choice. So they traveled far and long, and it was tough for Mary. This was a long and treacherous journey for Mary, and there were no planes or trains or automobiles. They had to go by foot or by mount the entire way. So they traveled on and on, Joseph caring for Mary along the way. And when they arrived, it was late, and they were desperate to find somewhere to stay. Some innkeepers were rustled from their bed to find these two looking for a place to stay. They pleaded for a place, but eventually some innkeepers got tired of it and told Mary and Joseph to just get out of here. This was hard, and they went from place to place, and most of the people were kind, but there was just no room. With the census going on, all the inns were booked up. I mean, Joseph did everything that he could, but there was no place. He tried to explain, "My wife is pregnant. She's going to have a baby." Joseph's anger even flared, I'm sure, and he said some things that he shouldn't have. But there was nothing anyone could do, and they were pushed off from place to place. So finally, they found someone who was more compassionate. They explained the situation fully to the innkeeper, hoping for mercy. They even got on their knees and begged and pleaded. And the innkeeper said, "Well, I don't have any rooms for you, but if you need a place, I've got some room in my stable." Now, Mary probably wasn't the happiest that this is where they would have to stay the night. Joseph should have at least made lodging arrangements. But it was safe and dry for the night. And although it was not a place of honor, it would serve as a birthplace for their son, Jesus.
Stars in the sky, look down where And in the same region there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased.
Well, in those days, the world was different. Less businessmen, more farmers and herders. And the Israelites, they like to raise sheep. Now, if you know anything about sheep, you know that they can get into some trouble. They like to cause mischief here and there, and they need people to watch over them to make sure they're safe. Well, wouldn't you know it? There were people who spent their entire lives out in the fields watching over the sheep both day and night. They would make sure none of them were hurt, and if they were sick or lost, they would go after them. Well, that night, the nearby shepherds were about to have their lives changed too. You see, there they were, minding their own business out in the fields, talking about the daily news, and suddenly angels appeared to them, knocking them down with their presence and glory. And the angels had such a wonderful message, a message of peace and hope, a message that would forever change the world, because a Savior was born for all people and would save all those who would come and believe. And those shepherds who had composed themselves fell down face first to worship. They stopped and listened to the angels. And the angels told them that in the city of David, they would find their Savior. And the shepherds understood and said, Okay, knowing that it was time to go and see the baby in the manger.
Thank you. Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the reign of King Herod. About that time, some wise men from eastern lands arrived in Jerusalem asking, "Where is the newborn King of the Jews? We saw his star as it rose, and we have come to worship him." King Herod was deeply disturbed when he heard this, as was everyone in Jerusalem. He called a meeting of the leading priests and teachers of the religious law and asked, "Where is the Messiah supposed to be born?" "In Bethlehem in Judea," they said, "for this is what the prophet wrote. And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are not least among the ruling cities of Judah, for a ruler will come from you, who will be the shepherd for my people Israel." Then Herod called a private meeting with the wise men, and he learned from them the time when the star first appeared. Then he told them, "Go to Bethlehem and search carefully for the child. And when you find him, come back and tell me, so I can go and worship too." After this interview, the wise men went their way, and the star they had seen in the east guided them to Bethlehem. It went ahead of them and stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were filled with joy.
Now, around that time, there were men from the east who were called magi. They were astrologers who would look up at the skies and see these amazing things, and they would tell each other about them as they tried to determine what they could mean. And they would scan the stars, looking for signs and wonders. And it came that they all found something right over there. It was something they couldn't deny. They had to go find out what it was. They were so excited. A king had to have been born. They had to go. They had to get out of there as fast as they could. And they traveled for miles and miles and miles, traveling a long way to bring the newborn king wonderful gifts, gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And they traveled a long way until they got to the land of Judea, into the household of the King of the Jews. Yeah, this old grump, Herod. Now, Herod was a pretty mean man and didn't like the idea of another king. But he listened to the Magi, who told him about the stars and how they showed them that there was a newborn King of the Jews, and how they had come to pay this king homage. The star was shining, and they had to find that king. Now, Herod was not happy. In fact, he was very mad. But he came up with an idea. "You go and worship, and then come back and tell me. Then I will go and worship this new king." Well, the Magi agreed and left. In reality, they would never see Herod again. They wouldn't trust him. So the Magi went out to find this newborn king so they might worship and praise him.
Thank you.
the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us. And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told to them concerning this child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them.
Well, in the city, those old shepherds and shepherdesses came and found the Savior, the one born and laid in a manger. So they bowed down and paid him homage. And those magi came too, probably quite a bit later, but for the sake of our story, they came too. But they gave their gifts and worshiped the newborn King of the Jews. And so they were all there, the lowly shepherds called by the angels sent by God to proclaim the news, faithful Mary and Joseph, and the magi who followed the stars. All of them, like we, join to celebrate the birth of a Savior, the one who's come, Jesus Christ, the Lord.
The dead will live again. praises of the Lamb. Mary, did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day rule the nation? And did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? This sleeping child you're holding is the great I am.
For years, I've wondered whether the Christmas Eve sermon is of any consequence or not. I imagine most preachers would be better off to read or tell the Luke's account of the Nativity of our Lord really well and then allow the carols and the candles and the Christ incarnate and the bread and wine to proclaim the good news of great joy for all people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is the Messiah, the Lord. So I've wondered, what can the Lord say through me this evening that will impact you in such a way that you will undergo some type of change or transformation? I've heard preachers justifiably bash economically powerful celebrations of Christmas. And indeed, Luke mentions the structures of political power, Augustus and Quirinius, but then he turns away from it. As preachers, we are proud to proclaim that emperors and governments and laws and world orders are upstaged by God and are rendered servants of God's saving purpose. But there's a whole lot more to God's story. When we read the Christmas story in context, we realize that Luke turns away from religious as well as political power, the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas. You know, the Word of God didn't go to the religious. The angel's announcement of the fulfillment of prophecy goes not to the temple, but to shepherds living in the fields. And the Word of God came to John not in his father Zacharias' office in the temple, but out in the wilderness. So I imagine hearing the startling word that if we want to experience the newborn Christ and take Luke's account seriously, the last place to be on Christmas Eve is in the church building. Because Jesus is being born where people need Him most. Most of us, if we're honest, we long to spend Christmas Eve physically and or spiritually, either in the glow of a tree-lit sanctuary with the nostalgia of carols and candles. And I know this is true because many of you have voiced those sentiments. But as is the case this year for most of us, we are in the warmth of our family home. And on that first Christmas, it is in the fields of the isolated, the disenfranchised, and the forgotten. Something like our own painful places of a spiritual wilderness that God speaks the good news of Christ coming there. God brings great joy to those who need it most there. You heard the children this evening share from Luke's gospel. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. We, for whom the church holds a central place, sometimes look upon the shepherds as outsiders. We sometimes portray the shepherds as desperate to hear and receive and own the Christmas gospel. You know, by the time of Jesus, shepherding had become a way of life, likely reserved for those at the bottom rung of the social ladder, by persons who could not find what was regarded as decent work. Society had stereotyped shepherds as liars and degenerates and thieves. Did you know that the testimony of shepherds was not admissible in court? And many towns had ordinances barring shepherds from their city limits. The religious establishment took on a particular dim view of shepherds, since the regular exercise of shepherds' duties kept them from observing the Sabbath, and so they were therefore rendered ritually unclean. The Pharisees classed shepherds with tax collectors and prostitutes, persons who were sinners by virtue of their vocation. See, we may have come to regard God sending angels to shepherds as bigger than reaching out to outsiders. Shepherding was a lonely occupation. You spend enough time in the field, shunned by decent and religious folks, disappointed by God or overwhelmed by grief, that you stop caring about being an outsider. You don't care. You don't care who you are. You don't care what other people think. You give up trying to get inside religion. You give up on God and you try to get on with life. But you know, the good news is God does not give up on you. God does not give up on us. Christmas is about God sending angels to people who have given up on God. How would you respond to God sending angels to you when you had given up on God? Like the shepherd, I'd be terrified. I don't know about you, but I'd be terrified. But think about it. In Jesus, God comes in a way that is far from frightening. Jesus comes vulnerably, helplessly, as a child wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger, which is translated means feed trough. Jesus is born like any other baby, except Jesus is born on the road, laying in a feeding trough. There's no magi at the manger in this scene in Luke's gospel. Jesus is born among the lowly and the poor. And if you listen closely to Luke's telling of the story, Luke gives no hint that Jesus is anything special. There's no angel hovering over the stable because the angels are over in the field with the shepherds. In fact, Mary and Joseph only hear of angelic activity because the shepherds tell them that the angels were present. Could it be that those who feel responsible for giving birth to the Christ child or to Christmas or to Christmas worship will receive the good news of great joy, not from angelic inspiration, but from someone sent to us from out in the field? Yes, the babe born at Bethlehem, the Christ child, Jesus, is born to those who have been outside so long that they have given up on God. And my prayer is that in your hearing this on this Christmas Eve, it will truly be good news, because you know and love people who have been outside so long that they have given up on God. Who knows, that may even be you this evening. I know many people are down and so blue this Christmas because things have changed. We are out of our routine. Some say they cannot worship if they cannot come to the building to worship, or they can't, if they can't sing, they can't worship. Sing where you are. Who's stopping you? The good news is that this God is sending angels out into the field with good news of great joy, and Jesus is being born among people who have given up on Him. That will inspire me to sing of joy coming into the world and sleeping in heavenly peace. I pray that it will for you as well. Amen and amen. At this time, in your homes, wherever you are, wherever you're gathered, I hope you're gathered with family and friends. I want us to share in this time of Holy Communion. I pray that you have elements there in front of you, enough for everyone that's with you. And as we gather this evening around the table, know that it's Christ our Lord who invites us to His table. On all who love Him and seek to grow into His likeness, let us draw near with faith and make our humble confession and prepare to receive this holy sacrament. We do that by confessing our sins. Let me pray this prayer of confession. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own goodness, but in your unfailing mercies. We are not worthy that you should receive us, but give us your word, and we shall be healed through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That is proof of God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Let's move into the great Thanksgiving prayer. Lift up your hearts and give thanks to the Lord our God. Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, you made us in your image to love and be loved. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. By the suffering, death, and resurrection of your only Son, Jesus Christ, you delivered us from slavery to sin and death and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. And on the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread, he gave thanks to you, he broke the bread, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take and eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, and he gave thanks to you, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine, and make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, where you are, Let us join together in praying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day, Lord, our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who have trespassed against us. Lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. You may take your bread. If you want to use the intinction method in your home, you may. If you so choose to partake of the bread, you may partake of it now. When you have finished with the bread, then you may partake of the cup. I will choose to do the intinction method. Now that we have received the body and blood of Christ, let us give thanks to God for all the world that He has created and for the gift of life and for giving yourself to us in Jesus Christ, whose holy life, suffering and death, and glorious resurrection have delivered us from slavery to sin and death. And we thank you in the power of the Holy Spirit that you have fed us in the sacrament and united us with Christ and given us a foretaste of your heavenly banquet. We are your children, and yours is the glory now and forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And amen. So, you've noticed that the four Advent candles have been extinguished. And the reason for that is Advent is over. We're now at Christmas. The focus is on the Christ candle. And you know, one of the traditions of our Christmas Eve services have always been the candle lighting toward the end of the service with the singing of Silent Night. We're going to continue that tonight, even though we're doing our Christmas Eve service differently this year. We will still have a lighting of the candles. I hope that you have your candles ready there in your homes so you can also participate in this. But we know that we light our candles from the Christ candle. Because we know that it's the light of Christ in our lives that makes a difference in this world in which we live. And it's the light of Christ that we carry out into the world when we leave this time of worship. And it's the light of Christ that we carry everywhere, each and every day. Now, I pray that this is a real, true reminder of that this year. So now you can go ahead and light the candles in your home to represent the lighting of the light in the circle that we would normally do if we were together here in the sanctuary. I will also light some candles to help represent the light of the world.
In him there is life, and his life is our light. This light shines in the dark, and the darkness will never overcome it.